Hello, my name is Cal Molinet from Richmond, Virginia, and I'm an anarchist, and I'm here once more at VCU to spread the message of freedom. I'd like to make an announcement that tomorrow night, Wednesday night, at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, I'll be once again hosting my monthly show, Fight the Matrix, at liberate.me. The topic I'll be approaching would be how security would be provided in a free market society, in a free society based on consent. Because remember, here, the Supreme Court has ruled many times that you have the police have no obligation, no constitutional duty to protect your life, your liberty, your freedom, or your property. So with that, I'm going to continue doing what I do best and see you guys at the victory party. Take good care. So that's how this organization is immoral, I guess, in that it contradicts that which we are already against. This organization, this matrix, only knows how to solve problems through one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve any problems versus the plurality of non-violent solutions that you and I already share.
I would make a counterpoint, and there's also the dichotomy of liberty and paternalism.
Paternalism?
Paternalism, such as laws. In a fully liberal, liberated society, such as anarchy, there is actually less liberty than you would assume, because everyone is at each other's throats, so to say. I'm dumbing this down a little bit. But there is constant conflict in that one person's opinion of what is their right to do in a fully liberal anarchy situation,
right,
would contradict someone else's view, and then there would be a clash.
Right.
So in a sense, the ultimate way to have a truly liberal society to the maximum utility of that liberty, you need a little bit of paternalism, you need a rules and systems. Granted, you have to enforce that rules in a certain way. But I do believe that we are going about it the wrong way in violence. I mean, I feel our police force doesn't need to be a paramilitary organization. I feel it needs to be more like the British system, where they have the bobbies who use non-lethal force, except in moments where guns are actually present.
Okay, so let me, counter that one real quickly. All right, so when we talk about anarchy, or like entomology, all that means is without political rulers. Like anions and cations in science, and means without archy means rulers. Without political ruler, without a stranger who arbitrarily dictates their opinion should be forced at gunpoint onto anyone else. Right?
Does that just mean no political system?
Ruler. You can have rules.
You can have rules, but who dictates those rules?
You do.
So you have still a democracy then?
Not so much like that.
It's a council rule?
It'd be like a polycentric legal system.
So like tribalism, kind of.
Kind of like that. So you have thousands of competing communities then catering to your lifestyle preference with rules to give explicit consent to and to the consequences. So you can have one that's 420 friendly, one next door that's not. Amish community works that way. They know that babies cannot give consent, so they wait until the age of 18 to give consent to the rules, and the only consequences that particular community has is social ostracism.
Right, they expel them.
Right, and then that's it. There's no capital punishment, there's no fines, there's no stockades, there's nothing like that.
Right.
You can have then thousands of competing communities with these dispute resolution. That's really what the law is, to resolve disputes.
So what about the disputes between the disparity in resources? Like one community will be short on one resource and they'll have to trade for that.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Ideally, they would have to trade.
Yeah.
But traditionally, for the past, before this last 20th century, before that, it was mostly all those resource differences were solved through violence.
You can look at the Wild West was actually not that wild before they went.
No, it was mostly fictionalized.
Right, yeah, okay, so it'll kind of be like that. There is respect for private property.
Right.
Right? Today, there is no respect for that. Yeah, like we were talking earlier about you need some kind of security, like how the British is providing that, the bobbies, for example. The Supreme Court has ruled in many cases that the police have no constitutional duty to protect you.
No, they don't.
Right, so imagine that. Now
you call the police and you say there's a man in the neighborhood with a gun. They're not going to send anybody unless they're contractually obliged, like they do for school.
Right. Unless they're detained.
Or unless the person's detained or cornered.
Right.
Or there is an imminent threat to personal property or something like that.
Even still, they have no duty or obligation.
They don't have any duty. They don't have to put themselves at danger.
Right.
Their obligation is to...
To steal from you. Through extortion, the victimless crimes, through pulling you over for a traffic light, for getting your, taking you to court for
petty crimes like that are just the mainstay of income.
Right. So, like when we were talking about, like, Chesterfield, for example, has to give 270 extortion fines every day. They also have to arrest 90 people each and every day. That's their quota. They're not a consumer-driven business. They're not...
Shouldn't be that case.
Right, but that's the only way they can measure their standard performance. A real business would measure it by the amount of consumer subscribing, you know, the credit rate, like, a credit system in which people evaluate. Here's the customer reviews, right? I've been in the business for 10 years. I provide fair and impartial opinions in settling disputes, right? And that's essentially what a judge does. But when you go to the judge under a monopoly of courts, a monopoly in law, you have a stranger who dictates the terms. You know, it should be the judge who stands to attention when you walk into the room, right? You're the customer, right? It should be reversed the other way around. And you'll find thousands then of ways to settle these disputes in a free market society.
Right. Right. Well, most court cases, that if you can, you can sell them outside of court. I mean, people will definitely come to their own little...
Right. Yeah, that's right, right.
But in a disparity, then that's what you need a judge.
Well, that's why you need and that's why you'll have respect
for... Party.
Right, and you can arbitrate that. Like, right. An event, like in a contract in an apartment that says, like, no cats allowed, but I bring a cat on the premises, I agree to the consequences by which to dispute it. We already agreed ahead of time to go to a third-party neutral judge, right? And then we can have an appeal process. But at least that's neutral from both our ends.
Right.
Right? And so we can have those kind of resolutions of disputes. eBay has that, Etsy has that, your credit card company has that.
Right.
And so that will be replacing the monopoly in law then. So you wouldn't need a paternalistic top-down to resolve this.
Well, if you don't have a monopoly in law, and if you have two parties, then you have people playing off the mother, playing off the father kind of gig. They'll argue this law standard versus this law standard.
Right.
Which is kind of sometimes happens between states. If someone commits a crime in one state, but they're a citizen in another state, they'll try to move the thing.
Right. And then, so there'll be common law arbitrations that they'll find.
There'll be common law.
Right. Precedence. It's like, at least the very least, that they will respect private property. Right? For me, looking for a business, like, do you respect my private property? Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
The person who says otherwise, you know, no one's going to get any their subscribers, right? Or customers. They'll go out of business. So at least they will have the fundamental respect against theft, against murder, against rape, against assault.
Law is about property. The
exactly,
other,
yeah.
The other part of that is about dishonesty.
Right. Fraud, for example.
Yeah,
right?
Fraud.
Yeah.
Extortion. Coercion, all that.
Right.
Price gouging.
And everything outside of that would be preferences. So you
right.
can have a community that's against alcohol. Great. I will never drink alcohol in that community. Maybe
right.
I'll have a timeshare to see what it's like, experience what prohibition looks like,
right.
And then I'll go back to my other community, right? But at least those are rules I give explicit consent to.
Right.
Right. And I think that's kind of important.
I understand what you're saying is that when you're born in this society, you don't have the ability to consent.
Right.
And we have not had a constitutional Congress in a long time.
Well, it's not even a contract, even the Constitution. Or you never signed it.
Well, the idea is the government, the Constitution, I believe, or the Bill of Rights, must be a contract between the government and the people.
Yeah, I heard also between the states, so
right.
states' rights, for
right.
example, right? But at the same time, the 37 or so people who signed that contract, any contract, you would say, well, I didn't get power of attorney. How can I be beholden to a contract if
right.
I was not even alive back then? So that contract would only be beholden to those 37 plus people.
Right.
They never really had consent of the minorities, of children, of women,
right.
People who didn't even own land. So I couldn't even say that was really governed by the consent.
No, back then it was only people that had property.
Right. The aristocrats.
Or a certain amount of property.
Right. Exactly. So I find that to be kind of fraudulent to begin with. And otherwise, I would want to go to a society that is contractual. You have, like, you could show me your contract with your car payments, house payments, Netflix, AT&T.
Right. Well, back then, I feel like the argument for only having people that had property have the right to vote is because them all having the largest thing at risk if the law went poor for them. So to say, if it was a law that affected them in a negative way, they had the most to lose because property was the biggest thing of importance back then. They didn't really have social benefits like Social Security or Medicare. That stuff was a relatively modern thing. They didn't really have the health insurance back then.
Well, before Medicaid, before Lyndon Johnson's war on
right.
poverty, there was friendly societies, mutual aid societies,
right.
that did provide this sort of stuff.
Right.
So you could find already in an absence of government intervention, these things can be provided.
The government is too big right now.
It always gets big.
It always gets big.
The smallest city-state turns into an empire. Right. It's 1% tax in the very beginning, 2%, 3%. Now
right.
it's only half our income.
Well, it's not, run like
well,
a business.
I don't, well, you can't really, they don't even know how to function as a business. They, like ABC, for example, has a monopoly on distilled spirits.
Right.
Or no, better example, USPS has a monopoly on delivering pieces of paper, first-class
right.
mail. It's illegal and criminal for FedEx, UPS, DHL to compete in that market. But in that market, all to themselves, they're $16 billion in debt. They're considering cutting off Saturdays. You know how they solve long wait lines? By removing the clocks. so you don't know how long you've been waiting in line. Very Kafkaesque. Right, so they're not a business, they're not efficient.
That's what they do in Vegas.
A real business, right. A real business can efficiently allocate those resources, right? Government, even though they can't even go bankrupt, and that's what I would want.
Is it a problem that in certain, and an idea of businesses, that they have too much change in management too frequently? Are we voting too frequently, is one question.
I wouldn't say voting too frequently. I would say like the whole thing's kind of set up to amass a lot of wealth as a politician,
right,
to kind of steal that much. You know, as a monarch, you have a long time to kind of amass that wealth.
Right.
Now you can share this privilege of political rulership with other politicians to amass a lot of wealth in a short amount of time and just kind of rotate them in and out of office. It's another form of a king. It's another form of
an oligarchy.
Huh?
Oligarchy.
Yeah. It's another form of controlling us as tax slaves,
right,
and stealing our property and stealing our wealth. For example, here, like the city council here in Richmond, told Hardy Brewery that they didn't have to pay meal taxes. That beer was not a meal. They came like a year ago. It's like, you sure that, you know, beer's not a meal? We don't owe you anything. A year later, retroactively, they say, actually, you owe us $40,000. It's like, what are you talking about? You said explicitly that we wouldn't owe you any taxes. But apparently they do. And that's $40,000 that could have been hiring a new employee,
right,
increasing the facilities,
right,
having, you know, lowering prices. But that goes to the political
extortion.
Job.
You agree that it's extortion,
right,
and that it's...
Therefore, it can't be a business then.
Yeah, it's a facade.
Like the mafia example you were mentioning earlier.
Yeah, it's a facade.
Yeah. So they don't produce wealth.
They don't produce goods.
They don't produce goods. I'm very amazed that you're very, where's your background in this stuff from? What other books have you been reading?
Oh, no, I just keep my ears open.
Yeah.
I'm a cynic.
A cynic? Nice.
But my family, we talk about politics a lot.
Right.
We're pretty moderate conservatives.
Moderate conservatives? Okay. All right. So a good appreciation of capitalism then.
Well, yes. Right. Definitely capitalistic in one sense, but we also healthcare background, so we see all that.
Right.
So we're socially liberal in certain senses and physically conservative.
Right.
Which is sane, I think.
And I take the position otherwise to remove myself from politics altogether, right? Like, you'll say, like, one of the liberal policies in terms of cannabis is like, well, let's legalize that. What you're doing then is doing, like we were talking earlier, a sleight of hand trick. You're exchanging one form of cage for another, in which regulations and taxations, which you still do not obey, you'll be still sent to another cage, right? And 75 years is not a measure of success, though, to finally gain one scrap of our freedom to smoke a plant, but to have lost so many others in the same amount of time, right? So I finally...
This is more capitulation on their part, and that they can't effectively finance their form of... trapped.
Right. They have to make up new laws to keep...
They're basically giving a little leeway and saying, well, you can do this now. We'll just tax you. You pay us a little bit of royalty for doing this because we're allowing it.
Right.
And then if you do too much, though, we don't like that.
Right, yeah.
We're not really happy that you're doing this, so don't do too much.
Right.
Or spank you.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Exactly.
Yeah, that's right. But don't eat too much candy, kid.
Right. It's like, look, who are you? A total stranger telling me what you can I do with your own body.
Right.
That's not freedom.
There's nothing more insulting than being told how to spend your money.
Right? At the same time, though, some of the positions we do advocate is also against spanking children. Let me make the argument really quickly. So like hitting a child, for example, only teaches them that violence is an alternative solution. That's all you teach them, that's the way to solve problems. Aside from the scientific facts to show that because the brain is still developing until the age of 4, the brain is still, you know, trying to make those hardwired connections. Any traumatic experience can misallocate those connections and lead to a positive correlation to addiction, to mental health crisis, to losing IQ points, right? So having that information at hand, you know, I wouldn't want even to take a risk of hurting my child, right? In the same manner that I don't use violence to solve my problems, I need to find creative ways to communicate with my child otherwise. Because otherwise, when the child asks why, and people say, because I said so, because I'm your father, I'm your mother, all you're teaching that child then is to obey authority, obey titles. And of course, when we grow up, we don't question then.
Type A personality you're teaching.
Yeah, we don't question government. That's another paternal figure. And it's, I guess.
Like I said, paternalism.
Paternalist, right, yeah. It's a projection of the childhood abuses, it seems to me like. To act strangers for permission to be free seems the same way, right? And then to acknowledge the legitimacy that they have that can control over your life. It's the same thing as a child asking a parent for permission. Do you still ask your parents for permission to drink a beer, right? Or
not anymore.
Not anymore.
Because I have another paternal figure that I've already asked permission for. That rules them in one sense.
Right.
They give me a special little card that says it's okay. Except
I know, after right? a certain time at night.
Right. Prohibition's still very much alive. People forget they have a monopoly on distilled spirits here.
True, I mean, well, you go to New York City, you can drink till like, what, 4 or 5 a.m.?
4, yeah. Well, it's so I find that to be the difference then of other states. It's like, they have better, they treat their tax rates better than us. You know, they have a nicer cage than us when you want to compare laws of other tax farms, like New York City. And I'd rather focus not on...
I like Norway.
You like Norway?
Yeah. I mean, the Scandinavian countries have do things a little differently, but then again, their populations are a lot smaller.
And they have really high taxes.
They do have really high taxes, but the taxes goes benefits everybody, not just a select few, which is what some people really dislike. It's like, why am I paying taxes if I don't get the benefits of paying these taxes?
Right.
It should be an investment rather than an extortion.
Right. If it's going to be that way, then have a free market competition to provide those services.
Right.
When you have
exactly.
Quality improves.
There should be only
down,
a temporary monopoly of the government, and it's still going to sell off those rights.
I don't know about temporary. Because it's
well, if they have to start something. They'll have to form regulations to test out how things are done,
right.
What systems work, and then they sell the rights to those assets to the companies for a small fee, of course, and then those companies create that free market. But we also have to prevent those companies from forming their own monopolies, such as Microsoft or Apple, or Google at this point is going to be the next trillion-dollar company.
All right, so what is it about monopolies then that you're concerned about?
Price gouging.
Price gouging? Okay.
Right.
So when you have a free market...
Or look at Comcast, Time Warner.
Right, yeah, and they're able...
For them, it's an information monopoly.
Right. But a lot of them get help from government to prevent entry-level
right, they get subsidized.
Right, they get subsidized. Like the agriculture business gets subsidized. Like Microsoft relies a lot on IP, which wouldn't exist in a free market society, to have leverage over a lot of people. Millions of dollars spent in more
companies.
Right, so without government to bribe and to force your way onto other people without their monopoly law, you have a polycentric legal system. State-backed corporations cease to exist.
Thing that's happened speaking of corporations, citizen corporations have been deemed the same as the citizen or the same rights. It's not true. It's an entity. It's more like a guild.
Right. It's a sanctioned cartel by government laws and like the Automotive Association here trying to prevent Tesla from entering the market.
By giving rights of citizenship to a company, I'd say they're in one sense telling us that they have a right to voice in government matters, but in truth, what happens is that those with money have the voice. Because people are more willing to listen to someone who will pay them for their time.
Right. Yeah. You could easily bribe these psychopaths in power that they're addicted to. But I would say again...
Right, no, what you do is you... give a donation to their fund and then say, may I come meet you sometime?
Right.
And they'll say, yeah, sure. So I just want to discuss some policies that you have, and I want to just try and convince you
right.
that you should change your ways or continue doing what you're doing.
Or at least add an exception for our business that these laws don't apply to us. This happened to Joe Biden.
Or just to show that this would be an unfair sanction against your people that work here.
Right, yeah.
Your constituents.
Right. So you wouldn't have any of that thing.
Right, it's just soothsaying, it's right. talking, it's bribery, it's prostitution.
Right. Yeah, at your expense, at any would-be entrepreneur's expense. So I agree with that. And that's why, for me, you can't have even a little bit of government because they're going to allow that to exist. I mean, they want...
I still think there should be a government system in that there should be a way for people to access an impartial judicial system. I think that it was required of government for society.
Okay. Well, how is it impartial if the police and the state work on the same side?
It should be impartial, not it's necessarily impartial, but sanctioned by the general populace, these votes. That's why the Congress, it's complicated, obviously, but there still needs to be a little bit of paternalism.
Well, I want to be able to choose my own dispute resolution, or the person who resolved those disputes. I want to be able
Right, but you're a sane and logical person. What about the insane person who thinks violence is the answer?
All right, the 1%, like cops, for example. I would say about a majority of us don't really view that way. I ask these questions often, like the first three questions. Hey, Tyler, if you use violence, so far I have recorded 200 interviews, and they all agree that they don't. They all agree against using violence to solve the problems. I think that's another kind of sleight of hand misjudgment that they've been...
Well, you're also asking college students who are quite educated and intelligent who probably have a nice background.
Well, where do you start?
So the Hobbesian myth is that, like, we couldn't actually meet the needs we would have because there wouldn't be a social order to make sure we wouldn't rob and steal from each other.
Because the judge has to allow the cops to steal your private property in order to protect your private property. Right? That's kind of a contradiction there. How can they protect my life when they have to rob me from my life's worth and my labor, my wealth, in order to protect it? A private business would be, you know, look, here's my, like an Etsy or like eBay. I've been in the business for 10 years, here's my customer review system. You can have internal regulation systems that are voluntary. I don't shop from anyone who has like a one star and reading the reviews and like how tremendous and, you know, horrible that they are, right? Then the product never, you know, arrives on time, you know, always comes broken.
Right.
Right. You can still have consumer reports that's based on that integrity, right? The moment that other competing agency finds that they're not being, fulfilling that integrity, they'll be the first one to alert everyone else. Right. Look, go with us instead, right?
But every extortionist has a very clear objective to make sure that they're the only one extorting you, you know, because then if you have other places that you can have extortion from, how are you even going to turn
market
a profit?
Share.
Well, that's the thing, like, who says they should have market share within your property? And then what if you had, like, we already have that, right? We have federal tax, we have state tax, we have sales tax.
Property tax, income tax.
Exactly.
Inheritance tax.
So yeah. It's still all done through government as opposed to just the mob. But you can see it's the same kind of tactics. And like, we assume that they're the best at doing those.
Yeah.
Well, but it shouldn't be, and it doesn't have to be. And they're making it just a third party thing that really could just be between them.
We need a little bit of a tabula rasa, so to say.
It's a clean slate?
Yeah.
Well, that goes again with peaceful parenting, right? Don't teach them this is a viable solution, then they won't advocate for the legitimized mafia, right? That's something that they kind of grew up with, and kind of seems to be legitimate around here.
Right.
And so that's a way
but
to kind of...
How they sell it is they tell us that it's not a mafia because you're part of it too.
You're part of it too, right?
Right.
Right. And then
it's more of...
Well, then that's when you say, well, show me factual evidence to have a contractual relationship with this mafia.
Right.
Right. It doesn't exist. And you start dispelling those...
But
it's coercive. It's non-consensual. It's non-contractual. Versus a free market society, you have thousands of competing offers. Not just one idea will provide a solution. You have like millions of competing ideas. And say, you know what? We can provide it better. We can do it better. Here's an alternative. Here's one that meets your niche and your needs, right? Whereas the government says, well, here's the whole package. You have to accept it. So they can't really, know whether they're overproducing or underproducing. There's no market price system that the free market does provide. And anytime you have a monopoly, again, the quality depreciates, like USPS and just removing their clocks, right? Or the long wait lines that you have.
The quality in general has been decreasing and the prices have still been
lower. Right, right. So it's like, knowing that, those kind of fundamental economic laws that we kind of find with that, then it will behoove us then to get away from that which that creates them, right? If we want to start a clean slate, let's start with fundamental principles that we already share and build a new society from there. Not ascribing from utopia, I want there to be problems, but at least in a way that we can upgrade, update, still find a plurality of non-violent solutions.
Not just updated, but a timely update.
Yeah, yeah.
Because how we have things now, things are so immense that it takes years for any policy to truly come
right.
into effect.
Yeah.
Obamacare has taken, 6 years?
Right.
Since
and the website didn't work, and he's threatening people to sign up on it. World Warcraft
yeah, well,
had a
the problem
Warcraft.
Is that... people are leaving their other insurance companies because he's affected the market share so much that instead of people continuing to pay the taxes in the system to support it, people are leaving the system and trying to go into Obamacare to have it support themselves.
Right.
So basically he's increasing the number of people that are taking insurance from the government, but decreasing the number of people that are actually paying taxes into it.
Right.
So he's creating an implosive situation. which is going to be terrible for the presidency. He's basically just handing a ticking time bomb to the next presidency.
Well, that's how
they're going to play hot potato with it.
Exactly. That's how they trick our grandparents for Social Security. Hey, it's only going to cost this much in the first year. Really? Yeah, and the politician is out of office in the next 4 years, and you kick off the debt for the next generation to the next generation.
Right,
and
now it's up to
you, right?
Most of our deficit is to ourselves.
Yeah. So, like,
and then the problem is the people who are in office, from what my understanding is, they kind of get this, like, I'm going to be here for a little while, let me do what I can, and then get out.
Right. Right.
And then it's someone else's problem.
Right.
It's a shirking responsibility.
Well, it's not like they have much of a responsibility. I mean, it's the mafia. What responsibility do they have to steal from you?
They want the position, the power to gain something.
Right. My friend will get it. I mean, that's not how a business runs.
No, it's insane.
Yeah.
Because in a business, the employees, we're thinking long term, I'm going to be here for all I'm going to do some quality work to maintain my position.
Right. I'm going to invest in marketing to show that I need to recoup. I'm going to be here for a while.
Right.
Here's the insurances. Here's guarantees. You know,
this is what I've done well.
Right.
And
reputation based, merit based.
Right, it's going to be merit based. Most of this is mostly hearsay.
Right.
And word of mouth.
Right.
It's complicated. It's not working, but I think it's the best thing we have right now.
I don't think so. I mean, 2 million people suffering in cages for victimless crimes, most of them. So that's
that's something that we should prevent.
But you can't. You can't rein in the leviathan. No one can. That's how it grows, like a tumor. It has to grow. It has to keep exploding. It has to tax
it. It's
going to
implode eventually. There is going to be a point where everything hits the fan.
Well, yeah, secession is inevitable. And historically, it's always been inevitable. It doesn't necessarily mean you have to be violent, but the separation, that's inevitable. What we do during that transition, I think, is important in not rebooting the matrix.
Right.
Right.
Let's not recreate the same problem.
I was like, look, yeah. And I think then it behooves us, those who are, I guess, in the know and understanding, I guess, educational-wise, what has happened in the past.
You're obliged to be true, nothing like that.
Right. Like if you see someone choking in a restaurant, you know how to, do you turn over and continue eating or do you do something?
Stay in the crowd and watch.
Right.
It's bystanders effect.
Right.
I'm really good at this.
It's not just in the prison, it's definitely in the political setting too.
Right.
Everybody thinks so, someone else will take care of it.
Right. They assume, I ask them much, like places in Europe don't really care much about the poor because they pay taxes. I don't have to care if they pay taxes.
Right, the government will take care of it.
Right. I don't have to call the cops because the cops will take care of it. You know, I pay taxes for it, right? So that removes the responsibility or like...
It's a lot of assumptions.
Yeah, or an obligation of duty to respect each other and their space. And that's something that they readily remove. And they readily do trick us into believing that any one of us could be like a serial killer or a would-be warlord, therefore government, right? Fear-based mongering tactics, which only increases their emerging powers, right? So that I've found, otherwise, I need to believe the same way.
Well, a lot of it's all based on deception.
Right, right. And that's how you control apocalypse. That's how you control your tax lives. Get them to play against one another. Don't trust one another. Right.
So it's all about debunking tactics.
Yeah, yeah. Cool, man. Well, I'm Cal.
Brian,
pleasure. I have pamphlets if you like. I think I think you'll like a lot of the stuff here. So that's how government or this organization is immoral. This organization only knows how to solve problems then through one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve any problems versus the plurality of nonviolence uses that you and I already share. So what are your thoughts?
Oh, I think that's really interesting. I've had very similar debates, but since you say it all in such a very compact manner, it kind of opens my mind a little bit more. And I do agree on the final saying. Unfortunately, we are born in this society. We don't have a say into how we got here because we were just born here. So yeah, that's just a really interesting topic to think about.
Thank you. And you did touch on a fun important part. You're like in the matrix. You're born into the matrix. You don't have a choice, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what government is objectively, and the things that you're born into the system, they have a monopoly on the services you and I want. I want roads. I want security. I want law. I want first class mail. Right. But they have monopolized these services in which you don't have the freedom to cancel or unsubscribe as you would from a real business. Right? Or the freedom to compete entrepreneurially to say, you know what, I can provide you a better service. It's not going to be harmful or abusive to you, the consumer. Right? So you don't even have that freedom. So like Social Security is something when you were born, they force onto you. You didn't say yes. You didn't give consent. You don't sign a contract. But you're forced to pay for it. And when it's time for you to retire, though, of course, there'll be nothing left for you.
That's correct.
Right?
And that's also very interesting because in my country, Bolivia, the elections just came in last Sunday. And the president, Evo Morales, he was very supported in his first term. And now that people don't want him anymore, the other candidates also are supported, but are more supported in this term because they just want to anchor Evo. They don't want him to win. So it's basically who does the least amount of damage, but they know that everyone is corrupt. And that's the sad truth, I guess, right?
And I agree very much. I too am from Bolivia. From La Paz.
También.
También.
Wow.
Yeah. I would say most of my understanding of politics ever come from the way it's down there. But everybody knows it's corrupt. Sure. Everybody knows you can buy influence there. Everybody knows you can buy judges, cops.
Basically. Wow, really?
Yeah.
That's awesome. It was so nice to meet you.
Mr. Gusa, my name is Cal.
I'm
Caliman.
Caliman? Yeah. Soy Nicola.
Nicola? Pleasure to meet you. We're part of a non-political organization, so no politics. We're done with that. We want to go to a free society based on consent that's contractual versus government. Because again, you're talking like you're born into this, and then when people say, well, government protects it, well, you don't have a contractual relationship with government. You can't show me your contract, right? It's like Sprint forcing you a service. You can't cancel a subscriber, go anywhere else to compete, right? But let me give you some pamphlets then.
Right,
that's pretty cool.
Yeah.